Hello, everyone. I'm Jim Garrison, and I want to welcome you to day 124 of Humanity Rising, which Ubiquity University and nearly 350 organizations now have been bringing to you since the 22nd of May as really an offering so that people from around the world can come together and share their experiences of what it's like going through this extraordinary pandemic that has put us all under some form of lockdown and social distancing, and to confer as to how we can increase our strategic effectiveness so that we can make a difference in the post-pandemic world. Over the weekend, several nations set further records. The United States set an all-time record of 83,000 new COVID cases. And this is at a time when the Trump administration is actively trying to limit the number of people that are tested. France reported over 50,000 new cases. So there's now appearing a new phenomenon in the struggle against the pandemic. And that's what is being termed circuit breaker lockdown. Unlike in the spring, where people just were put, like in Italy, under martial law and draconian measured by the government in an indefinite way because people had no idea what was going to transpire. Now the governments are doing a circuit breaker style. So for example, Wales has announced 2 weeks. The Czech Republic has announced 12 days. Northern Ireland, 4 weeks. Republic of Ireland, 6 weeks. As country after country is experiencing surges in the COVID cases, doesn't want to shut down the economy. And so is trying sort of a quick hit, isolating people, locking them down, but with a time limit. And we'll see if this works. But even in Sweden, where it appeared that a country had been able to basically emerge unscathed, the number of cases is going up even in Sweden. So we have a situation that we're all navigating through. And it's very important that we understand it and we take proper precautions as we take it one day at a time. Before I turn it over to Sabinia, who will commence our program, I wanna also just note the special session that we had this past Saturday, commemorating the 75th anniversary of the United Nations. We had a marvelous assemblage of young people from all over the world that expressed youthful ardor and enthusiasm for this organization now 75 years strong that has been carrying the light of international security and global friendship and collaboration to solve problems that, as we all know, are almost all global in scope and beyond the capacity of any one nation or even several nations to solve. We're in one world, and the United Nations represents that one world. Warts and all, failures, successes and all, and with all the vicissitudes that that institution has endured, mostly at the hands of the most powerful nation states that have made it impossible for it to fulfill its mission as it could have done had everybody entered into it in the same spirit with which Franklin Delano Roosevelt founded it back in 1945. One thing that I didn't know on Saturday, and it didn't hit the news until after our session was over, is that Honduras became the 50th nation to sign the treaty for the prohibition of nuclear weapons. And when Honduras assigned the treaty, which will go into effect next January, for the first time since Hiroshima and Nagasaki 75 years ago, the world has a treaty that is actually outlawing nuclear weapons. No treaty to date actually outlawed nuclear weapons. And it was passed by the UN over the objections of the United States, Russia, China, France, Britain, Pakistan, India, South Africa, all the nations that have nuclear weapons don't want treaties to limit nuclear weapons. It's the most extraordinary thing. And nevertheless, the United Nations, to its everlasting credit, stood firm and passed a treaty. And it may not go into effect in the ways that we would like, given the opposition by the nuclear weapons states, but it is a testament to the nobility of the human spirit and the vision and courage on the part of that international agency to secure the future of humankind. So that's the 75th anniversary of the United Nations as we gather here today. So thank you everyone for joining. And it's my pleasure now to turn it over to my co-moderator, Sabinia von Gafka, who will commence our program. Sabinia.
Thank you so much, Jim, and a warm welcome to all of our viewers around the world and also our dedicated viewers in our chat who are with us each and every day. It's amazing for me to be back. And also, I am every single day amazed when I listen to the different conversations on humanity rising, on the collaborative nature that is really surfacing and really weaving together in such an organic way, but also being that sort of path weaver forward that can hopefully facilitate and navigate us to where we want to be heading, but also really open space, as you mentioned, Jim, for communication and for diverse thoughts, expressions, and perceptions to be distilled down on one platform. And today we're talking about art and the revolution. And it truly, art has had its impact on the evolution of humanity and our planet since day one, because it is an expression of so many things. And just to quote Albert Einstein, who said, "The revolution introduced me to art, and in turn, art introduced me to the revolution." And also, as it was said for this session, that we're no longer in an era of change only, we're actually in a change of eras. Where all aspects of humanity and our systems and our planet are really going through a process of radical change and transformation. And I believe, and there are so many expressions of this, that art in the time of evolutionary change can truly be a catalyst. And the fusion or the collaborative nature also of art on one hand, science on another, and then you intertwine it with storytelling or creating a new narrative that we so many times mention within Humanity Rising, can in itself also be a path weaver and a facilitator of change going forward. And I also think that art really has the power to on one side, allow ourselves to get lost into something, whether it's an imagination or a perception. And on the other hand, we can also find ourselves in art out of a different perspective. And I also find that it's a communicator and sort of an unveiling or surfacing of clarity that allows both for us perceiving the challenges that exist, but also the solutions that exist and also the patterns that exist. And today I think it's transitioned more to be multidimensional with the way we utilize social media and all other platforms of communication. And I read somewhere that art is imaginary beauty in possibility of accomplishments. And I just thought that sentence was few words, but packed in so many different varieties, because art truly is in the eye of the beholder. We see what we perceive. And I also want to sort of weave in the art of beauty, because I think it was Fyodor Dostoevsky who said, you know, beauty can really save the world. And I think this is becoming more and more apparent. If we really understand what we mean when we say beauty, it is everything around us, all our interconnectedness, our planet, our resources, nature. And beauty has something that grabs deeper into the human heart and really gets that coherence of our heart and the interconnection. Because somehow you can't really argue with beauty, even though it's in the eye of the beholder. You can argue maybe about it, but not with beauty. And we can really find beauty expressed in every single breath that we take, if we allow it. And speaking of breath, I just thought that we would open up, as we have done before, in a breath of heart coherence, to really align ourselves with here and now, and also open this, let's say, sacred space for where we are now for a dialogue with four amazing panelists who are going to be joining us shortly. So just with easy exhales and inhales during 1 minute to the sound of a beautiful mantra, let's just close our eyes, put your hand on your heart if you want to, and then just start to inhale and exhale for a few breaths. Taking that just that single minute that really can get us aligned and focused. And with that, we have a really interesting and exciting session ahead of us, talking about art and the revolution with four amazing panelists. I'll just mention them briefly. We have Espireda Ananas Amnetista, who is a social scientist, a writer, an international lecturer, and also an ambassador for Damanhur, and I would say an expert on intentional living. And then we have Sally Annett, who is an artist, producer, and author who works at the intersection of what I mentioned before, art, science, and language. And David Pearl, who is an opera singer, business consultant, who uses his artistic expression in his work with companies around the world. And David Woolcombe, who is a social activist and the founder of Peace Child, that I'm sure that he will convey more about. So with that, I hand over the word to our panel.
Thank you, Sabina.
I hand it back to you, Jim. Let's start with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Sabina. Before we jump in, I just want to note something that Paul Coleman put in the chat, which I had meant to and then forgot, actually, is that over the weekend, in addition to the reaching critical mass on the nuclear weapons treaty, Chile had an election where 80% of the electorate voted for a new constitution and a new General Assembly based on gender equality that would commence next year. This was a beautiful event. We all remember Chile and what it's endured since the coup in 1973 with the Nixon administration and Colonel Pinochet. It's been a long road for the Chileans, but it appears that in the end, the progressive forces of Salvador Allende are once again at the forefront of Chilean history. So it's a beautiful moment that we should celebrate today. The issue of art and the revolution is something that struck me when I was talking initially with David Pearl, who, as you will remember, was on our program last week, leading us through an exercise in street wisdom. You know, how do you approach the very august issue of wisdom? Well, you can do it through art. And he's been amazingly effective. And David Wolcom with Peace Child was also in conversation with David, who many of you know in the 1980s and 90s and the 2000s generated a international movement called Peace Child International, so that young kids from all over the world and all kinds of languages were coming alive with the passion for peace. And then with Sally Annett, who's a new acquaintance, as I began to get to know her and realize that she was an extraordinary artist at the interface, as Sabina said, of art, science, and language, but who had just convened a major artistic expression called Lockdown 2020. Art, you know, in a time of COVID, what that all means. And then finally with Esperde Ananas, who I've known for many years, and for those of you who've been to Domenher, there's no better example I know of in the whole world of revolutionary spiritual art than in Domenher, where the Domenherians nearly 30 years ago, carved out of the solid rock of inside of a mountain, a temple to humankind that is on the scale of the pyramids. I mean, it's just a massive, massive artistic expression in stone about the next phase of human spiritual evolution and development. So I thought, as I was talking to all these people, that it would be a wonderful thing, especially the week before the U.S. election, when the fate of the earth is hanging in the balance, to celebrate not only the 75th anniversary of the United Nations and the nuclear treaty now and the Chilean plebiscite, but art and the revolution. Because there's no doubt we are in revolutionary times. And there's no doubt, since humanity first appeared, the first conscious expressions of human beings, 40, 50,000 years ago, was cave art. Human beings have expressed themselves with art and through art since before there was probably language, since before there were any alphabets to write anything down. Humans have sung songs and danced and carved, painted on the walls of caves. And ever since then, universally, without exceptions, in every culture that we've ever explored, humans are fundamentally, artistically creative. So as we find ourselves now in the long, dark tunnel of a pandemic that is not letting us go, how do we appreciate our creativity? How do we appreciate artistic expression? How do we understand art and the revolution in the spirit of Einstein, that it was art that introduced him to the revolution, and in turn, It was the revolution that introduced him to art. And it's a circular, non-ending spiral of history and creativity. So I want to just bring our panel on, and I want to just start with you, David Pearl. And I'd like each of you to just comment on how you, as an artist, how do you understand art and the revolution? David?
You always, the big questions. Well, thank you. It's a joy to be here. I'm honored to be asked the question and slightly intimidated by it. I luxuriate in the possibility I might be an artist, but I often feel it's something that other people say to you rather than you can claim for yourself. I mean, maybe I can just, the most helpful thing might be just to give two or three examples of how I found myself using art, if you can use art, to help things develop. I wouldn't lay claim to being a super revolutionary artist. I know people who are, you know, who there's a certain fearlessness in the arts community, and I feel what I've done is develop sleight of hand ways of bringing art in, or as you just said about the cave painting example, I often feel as though whilst it's tempting to think, oh, I'm bringing art into organizations, which I do, I think the honest truth is they reached out for it to be brought in. I think there's an act of reintegration that's going on that needs to be recognized. Many, many organizations, business and other, have over the last 20, 25 years reached out. They sense there's something missing and they've drawn a little bit on the arts. But I mean, if I just simply on for context, I think the two areas that I'm most involved in is bringing arts thinking and arts access to creativity into places, quite dry places, like, you know, business organizations, governmental organizations, and so on, where it doesn't naturally flourish. And the other is, as you say, in the streets with street wisdom, which is to take some of the techniques that artists are traditionally used to immerse themselves in their environment in order to get inspiration. But instead of doing it wandering, you know, through daffodils and forests, to do it wandering through parking meters and car parks, you know, to bring it into the city. And I suppose the most well-known thing that I've done in the arts and business world is the first thing, which was I got a well-known company to create and perform an opera, 1,500 of them, which is still talked about because it wasn't just singing the opera, it was creating it in every aspect, making it up, composing it, playing it, and so on. And I think I just tripped over something there, which has been a hallmark of my work, which is not to treat art as a sort of a ghetto or as a silo, but to approach it from the fact that everybody is an artist and work from there. And I think there are three things. I'm just going to put some provocation and then pass to my wonderful co-panelists. I was trying to think, you know, some things I've learned about the differences between the arts world, if there is one, and the non-arts world, if there is one. And I think there's two or three that that struck me as odd and made me important. The first is I was struck when I first started working with businesses, they spent a lot of time talking about what we should do. And artists spend a lot of time talking about what they want to do. There's a sense of agency in the arts, which seems to be lacking sometimes in organizations that operate on kind of rational principles and feel that if you could only get the right data, you could figure out what you ought to do. Whereas there's a kind of boldness and a kind of stupidity, or not stupidity, but it's a recklessness, which might come from the fact that, I'm not sure if you know this, but artists tend to earn less than business people, generally. And so maybe there's less at stake. The second thing that I found strange, and I've spoken and written about this, is that I did a talk for Google recently, a few years back, about where I drew on my own experience of mental dis-ease. And it was called Darkness is Part of Wholeness. And I think really briefly to say that the business world seems, or the business and other organizational world, the kind of the grown-up world, if we're going to call it that, which of course it isn't, but seems to regard darkness or difficulty, if we're going to call it that, as a sort of pathology to be solved. And the arts world seems to thrive on the dance between the light and the dark. And the third thing that I noticed is that in the world outside the arts, if there is one, people seem to concentrate on questions that can be answered. You know, you would, if you saw a group of business people sitting around, they would be asking questions to find the answer. Whereas if you find a group of artists sitting around, it's more likely they will ask questions that have no answer, that can't be answered. And the reason they do that, and I think this is the reason also the art exists, is to develop your organs of awareness, to develop the muscles of, I want to say critical thinking, but to sit, as Arnold Mundell says, to sit in the fire and to sit in those unanswerable questions and develop. And I think those are three things. Remembering that you're allowed to want things. Remembering that darkness isn't bad. And remembering that questions that have answers aren't necessarily the ones you should be asking are I think, gifts from the arts, which can help with this revolution. And I notice when I work with that stuff in the boardrooms of the world and elsewhere, they have a troubling effect, a helpfully troubling effect.
Thank you.
And maybe the last thing to say is not anything, but to sing something, because I've often noticed that if you, the same about art that kind of clicks conversations to the next level. And I remember sitting in Mozambique with quite a fraught conversation between the leading petrochemical company and the leading environmentalist. And someone then read a story, and the whole thing just kind of breathed up to a different level. So here's a phrase, and I thought Mozart would be good and it just struck me it might be a good phrase. Let me see, this was being played on the radio when my daughter Elsa was born. And it goes, un'aura amorosa del nostro tesoro, un dolce ristoro al cor porgerà, un'aura amorosa del nostro tesoro, un dolce ristoro al cor porgerà,
Thank you, David. Thank you. Beautiful. I was so hoping you would sing something. Because music, as you all know, transcends prose because it goes to the soul. And it goes to the soul because the whole cosmos is a song. And so thank you so much, David. Let's move to Asperide. Asperide, what would you say from the point of view of Domenher and the community you live with there in Northern Italy about the topic of art and the revolution?
Hi, everyone. it's interesting. I think one of the revolutionary aspects of art in my community is the idea that a collective of people can be an artist. So we are used in our epoch, at least, to exalt the individual artist, sometimes a small ensemble. But what we wanted to prove here is that everyone really is an artist. And then when we get together, we can create extraordinary works of art that have meaning and can be sacred. That's why we started building temples, exactly because there is the intention, the coordinated intention and effort and desire to tell a story that is shared by many, many people. So I would like to ask George if he can show the short video so that we know what I'm talking about when I talk about the incredible creativity that you can tap into when it's a collective of people working together. And then maybe I'll just comment or you comment on the images afterwards. It's just a very short one. And I'd like to introduce to you the temples of humankind that we built by hand inside a mountain. And this has been maybe one of the craziest things that I've ever seen in my life, and one of the reasons why I chose to join this community 28 years ago. So I thought, these are so crazy, I don't think I can find anyone more interesting, exciting, and out of the ordinary than this group of people. So George, I hope you can send it now, show it now.
1 second.
Thank you. So what we're going to see, and I stop talking as soon as it starts, is this complex of temples that we call the temples of humankind because they're dedicated to the divine in humanity. And then maybe that is also part of the revolutionary aspect of our art, that we wanted immediately to use art to awaken consciousness.
35,000 years ago, all over the world, the great creative revolution began. It was still the Ice Age. Suddenly, humans began to create art, dance, music, ritual. It was as if a divine spark of creativity had suddenly descended upon humanity to help us to reconnect with the source of all creation. Still today, art, dance, music and ritual are the most powerful creative instruments to awaken to the divine in each of us. It is to this awakening that the people of Dominor have dedicated the temples of humankind, a great work of art carved by hand into the rock in the heart of a mountain in northern Italy. The temples are a monumental artistic endeavor, a sacred container of devotion and pure ideals. The temples are a living book of knowledge. Every architectural detail, every angle and form has a meaning and follows a precise code of shapes and proportions. A journey through the different halls, their colors, shapes, and symbols is an immersion into the sacred wisdom of the past and the future, brought to life through the arts. It is a healing journey to remind us how much richness and power lay within the human spirit. The temples of humankind are a medicine for the soul. Look at these images. Listen to these sounds. Let the divine spark of creativity within you recognize its own power, shine its own light. Feel the divine within you. Feel yourself as a divine being, connected to the whole web of life. Walking in beauty and consciousness, finding our way back to love, hope, and unity. Together, we can create a new story and a new future for the awakening of all humanity.
So I hope you enjoyed it. And, you know, there is this also beautiful quote by Keats that he said, beauty is truth and truth is beauty. And so one of the things that motivated us was the idea of exploring truth, plural truths, through these temples, so that we can start to embrace more and more of the diversity that each one of us is, the divine realm is, and start to really recognize unity in that diversity. So it's not just one place, it's a complex of temples, it's a whole journey, so that we're constantly reminded of the need in this epoch, and not only the need, the possibility that we have now as human beings to really recognize what all of us as one, while respecting the uniqueness of each one of us as humans, the planet, the plants, and everything else that lives in the cosmos. So,
and just one quick question, Damanhur, the Asperity, about Damanhur, and that is the temples continue to be built, right? I mean, it's an ongoing process of kind of room after room as the whole edifice takes ongoing shape.
Yes, this part, the original part, is finished, but now we have an even greater project that is that of building a temple dedicated to concordance, which will contain the Parliament of Peoples. So if we can take this, you know, beautiful example of the United Nations, what we would like to do is create a sacred place that could be the United Nations of Indigenous people, so that we can not only gather their knowledge, also spread it through the mystical energies of the temples that we built to be an antenna also for cosmic energies. We can spread their values, their knowledge to more and more people around the planet to reawaken that way of living in harmony with the earth. Otherwise, we don't think we're going to have much of the future. And then from there also, hopefully, create the seed for new peoples to be born, which is we envision, you know, a world where the nations that have been created by drawing lines on the map will end, and we'll go back to peoples and communities that are connected by the love and the understanding of the needs of their land, and also a clear, understood, and shared connection with the afterworld. So we go back in the cycle of life, not only when we are alive, also when we are in the afterlife. And this is why we need sacred art also to reopen those doors. It's much more complex, but at least I hope I have presented why we feel it's so important to go back to this idea of sacred art as a people's art.
Yeah, good. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
David, welcome. Let's talk about art and the revolution as you've experienced and expressed it through Peace Child International.
And here I am. Thank you, Jim. I hope you can all see me, and what a delight it is to be here with this extraordinary panel. And thank you, Jim, for asking me. Now, some of you may not have heard of Peace Child. It's a musical play. And the thing about it is it starts in the future, 50 years in the future, and it tells the story of the world as we want it to be. And then we flash back to the children of the present, telling the story of what they do with their lives to bring about that future world. The mission statement is empowering young people to think about the world that they would like to be living in, and then tell the story of how they're going to go about living in it. And it's a musical, and the first one was all about imagining the world beyond the Cold War. And as you remember, Jim mentioned, Peace Child brought the first Soviet kids together with American kids, and we co-created that story of the future that they both wanted, and then tell the story of how it should be created. And it was co-created with the kids themselves. And they didn't think the bombs were the problem. They felt the fact was that their governments couldn't be friends like they were friends. And so it was all the story about how they forced their two leaders to go off on a fishing holiday together. Naive a little, but actually the foreign secretary, Secretary of State of the US and the foreign secretary of the Soviet Union did go off on a fishing holiday together. So life began to imitate art. And 3 years after we did that first Peace Child in Moscow with Russian and American kids, the Berlin Wall came down. Life imitated art. And I swear to God, we all felt that the kids who did Peace Child had a hand in creating that revolution. So art does create revolutions. And, you know, I always remember that line that Pete Seeger said about the Occupy movement. It's never going to get anywhere without a song. And I think Seeger was absolutely right. Revolutions need songs. And I remember the original mission of Peace Child when we first created was harnessing the arts in the service of peace. And I know some of you may be listening to this in your second or third language, but the word harnessing is really important. A harness is what you, it's a big old leather ring that you put around a horse's neck and it drags a chariot or it drags a stagecoach. And this is the idea that we had in Peace Child, that arts would actually drag the world into a peaceful state, into a revolutionary state. And Jim, thank you for mentioning that session we were both at on Saturday. Because, as you know, we were having our own dialogues with the Peace Child young people, and they were actually calling for the, you know, a revolution to actually get TPNW across the line. And on the day they were talking about it, it actually did get across the line. But they had actually come up with an idea to do go much further than that, to actually get the nuclear powers to endorse it. And their way of doing that was what they called the Digital UN. And a digital UN operates through international citizens' assemblies in exactly the same way that the Irish people managed to change thousands of years of history and get a legalization of abortion, gay marriage in Ireland, to have international citizens' assemblies backed up by global digital referenda. And in the final analysis, if governments don't do what young people and everybody else know that they have to do to avoid catastrophic climate change and the dangers of nuclear weapons, they back it up with school strikes and general strikes. And as we've seen in the last few months, young people are pretty good at going out on strike. And it's only by withdrawing your labor that you can get the revolution you need. Now, that's not my idea. That idea came out of the co-creation possibilities of theatrical improvisations with kids. And we'll see where that idea goes. But certainly the first idea did result in the ending of the Cold War, which was a pretty good revolution to get started with. But I've said that, you know, music is at the heart of, and arts is the heart of revolution. And it was interesting also last week in this series of workshops, we had an artist, a sculptor, who came on, and she works in the Caribbean with underwater sculptures. And she's created this beautiful metallic sculpture through which she pulses electricity. And not only does it look beautiful, it also restores coral. And another artist in Bangkok had an idea for a flood defense system, which would double as a vertical farm. And they created it as a work of art that looks the most beautiful thing that you can imagine. It's actually the biggest vertical farm in the world and also manages flood defenses. So creativity can drive the green revolution. And that's what we want to see. But these things do not come about through focus groups. As Goethe said, it starts with a decision. And I'd like, Georg, if you can run that first song, I, Who Am I, it asks the question of ourselves, who are we? What are we doing here?
Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's young Lily from Estonia singing in Ely Cathedral. And that's the question that we open every Peace Child with. All revolutions do need music. And if you look back, most of the muscular movements in history have engaged with music. The Russian Revolution was thick with it, and also very striking, rather unfamiliar art. And I think actually, rather than look at that, let's have a look at another fictional revolution based on the actual revolution of 1831 in Paris. It's music we all know, just a tad more famous than Peace Child. Let's go with it.
Do you hear the people singing the song of angry men? It is the music of a people who will not be slaves again. When the beating of your heart echoes the beating of the drums, there is a life about to start when tomorrow comes. Will you join in our crusade? Strong and stand with me. Beyond the barricade, is there a world you long to see?
Then join in the fight that will give you the right to be free.
Well, you see, rather like Henry V, Shakespeare's Henry V, that rousing speech, it does summon up the blood, the vigor of music. And I think I experienced that in the revolution in Nicaragua, where I was lucky enough to be. And I met with Carlos Mejia Godoy and his brother Luis Enrique. And we had a long session with Daniel Ortega and talked about the revolution. I don't remember a thing that Daniel Ortega said, and he spoke for about 4 hours. But I do remember the music of Carlos Mejia Godoy. And I'd love to play you a little extract of that now. Can we go with that?
El cerro de la Iguana, montaña dentro de las Segovias, se vio un resplandor extraño, como una aurora de medianoche. Los maizales se prendieron, los quiebraplatas se estremecieron. Llovió luz por Moyogalpa, por Tepaneca y por Chichigalpa.
Cristo ya nació en Malacahuila, de Chepe Pavón Pavón. Y una tal María, ella va a planchar muy humildemente la ropa que goza la mujer hermosa del terrateniente.
Now, Jim, as you will remember at that session on Saturday, the question came up, how do elders and young people co-create things together? And I talked about the UN 75 experience that I just had with the young people that I told you about. But Peace Child was created in that way. And it started when, you know, the first production was pretty low budget and I had to drive the kids to and from rehearsals. And I noticed that as I drove them back, that the jokes they were telling each other in the back seat of the car were actually funnier than the script that I'd written them. And so I noted them down, and the next day I gave them some new script with their jokes in it. And they said, hey, but that's what I said last night. And I said, you know, I know, it's great. Now you're going to say it from the stage of Peace Child in the Royal Albert Hall in London. And they said, wow, That's pretty fun. So they co-created Peace Child with me. And there was a wonderful example of that that we did in Somerset with an international group of children that they put together, drawn from all over the world. And I don't know if you know the West Country in England, but it's not many revolutions have started there. They're fairly sort of placid, lovely people. And this young man from Kenya really shook them up, but they got it. And music drives revolutions all over the world. And it is a totally international language. It's the language of peace. It's the language of change. And listen to young Raphael as he teaches the young people of this Peace Child production song from his culture. Go, Georg.
Oh, Kalyan.
Oh, Kalyan.
Akaraduka, Kalyan.
Akaraduka, Kalyan.
Oh, Kalyan.
Oh, Kalyan.
Then now, I sing my part and you sing your part. Kalyana,
oh Kalyan,
Kalyana, Kalyana,
oh
Kalyana.
Those kids' prejudices and the prejudice perhaps of the parents who were watching, I'm talking about racial prejudice, just dropped away, fell away, it no longer existed.
It's quite unusual for the white person to understand an African language and just sing the way it's supposed to be. So actually I think that's the most fascinating thing that I'll never forget in my life.
Thank you, Georg. You've got all of that perfectly. I would follow Raphael to the barricades, and I think all those kids on stage and most of the audience would too. Music whips up the spirits. It summons up the blood. It makes you feel great about yourself. Just listening to you, David Pearl, it gave me agency, what you did. And the music of Peace Child gives me agency too. I was always accused of having unrealistic aspirations, trying to end the Cold War in 1983, 1984. And I said, yep, that's what we want to do. Not for me, but for all the kids who are coming after me. We have to do this. We have the unrealistic aspiration now of getting the 5, 6, 7 nuclear powers to adopt the TPNW. And we have a whole load of climate change legislation to push through. We have to stop using the internal combustion engine in the next 5, 10 years. We have to criminalize the use of fossil fuels. These are big revolutions, guys. We're going to need some very, very powerful songs to summon up the people of this world to drive that revolution. And that's what we in Peace Child are trying to do. And we're empowering young people to co-create those songs with us. And if we had more time, I would play you some of their songs, because Peace Child has inspired some fabulous youth-created songs and raps and chants and wonderful things. But thank you, Jim, for allowing me to share this story with you. Thank you.
Oh, David, warms my heart, made me quite emotional, because I was there, you know, with David year after year supporting the Peace Child, and to know that it had such a dramatic effect. And, you know, reminded me of that great line from Napoleon, that a revolution is an idea who has found its bayonets. And I would rephrase that and say that in our time, a revolution is an idea who has found its art. And David Wolcom, everyone, did that as beautifully and as profoundly as anyone I know. It's out of the mouth of babes that the words of the Lord are uttered, and the children that were inspired and whose lives were transformed was a remarkable, remarkable process, decade after decade. And it's still going on. So it's a beautiful, beautiful expression of art in the revolution. Now let's turn to our final contributor today. And then when Sally finishes, we'll bring everybody together for a dialogue. Sally, Annett, who's, as we mentioned, is really at the living now in France and has been at that interface between art, science, and language, and just completed the exhibit on lockdown 2020. So Sally, speak to us about art and the revolution.
I think you're still muted, Sally.
Hopefully I'm here now. Hang on, let me do that.
Yes, it works, thank you.
Perfect, thank you everybody. It's very hard to follow those beautiful things. I am in France. We have just completed a really fascinating exhibition about COVID and about the lockdown, which featured artists who either had COVID or had breathing difficulties. And the exhibition focused on breath and breathing. But I think what I'd like to respond to the work and to the idea of artist revolution, and I'd like to respond on notions of truth, on notions of beauty that have been mentioned, on notions of abstraction, ritual, sacred space, all of those things. And I think art, firstly, is not a single medium. It's a way of exploring the world through sensual languages on a myriad of different levels. And revolution is driven, I think, by our appetites and desires. So be those freedom, hunger, anger, oppression, the same appetites and desires drive our homeostatic processes. It's a functional process. And the word revolution is a circular. It has a circular and repetitive notion. Art also tackles boundaries and taboos. So artists spot patterns. They look for the antinomian, they push boundaries, and they look for the new so they can shock or shatter or offend. It's all part of the process, and that antinomian then becomes the normal. Also, with my exploration of art, science, and humanities, and religion and alphabet, it's really clear that the home of ethics is neuroscience, but the literature that neuroscience and ethics is founded on is Kantian. It's still art history, it's still religious text. So these strands and interconnectivities flow from our past into our present and into our future. And I think my favorite writer about writing positive narratives, which is central to our practice here, is Jeffrey Kripal, who fervently believes that literature creates our future. So the stories and narratives that we write come to pass. And currently, that's a little worrying when we're living with Margaret Atwood and various dystopian futures. So a big part of our revolutionary practice, which seems very simple, is to write positive stories, to create positive narratives. And as part of being on, because I've had COVID and I've been in the COVID unit, and I'm here as part of that process of recovery, and I've met a lot of people who want to act and want to do things. And I would really urge people to write, to create positive stories, even if it's positive lists, because these things are so important. Gosh, so many wonderful things said. Also, where does art take place? Sacred spaces. Mercier Eliade and the idea of what is a sacred space. The mundane can be sacred. Sacred spaces are habits, are recipes, are clothing, it can be hidden in plain sight. Art can be poems, song, sculpture, music, performance, architecture, urban spaces, and the body. So it's about, art is an act of devotion in that sense. And it's not a single act of devotion, it's a continual act of devotion. And currently for me, and I think we spoke about this last week, is that we live in a post-truth space. It's a post-veritas world that we're living in. And in a time of post-truth, honesty is a revolutionary act. And walking the path of honesty is hard. And possibly the hardest and the first step is honesty with yourself. And as part of our practice, again, we encourage collaboration and international, intergenerational and collaboration across all media. And I had prepared a little low-tech piece, which in comparison to everybody else's piece of work is rather minimal. But I hope you can all see that. And so, yeah, the revolution currently we're living in, what is described as an Anthropocene, and the art and science world is heading, looking at either transhuman, post-human, anti-human, if you're looking at various philosophers. And we're looking at the integration of tech and organic matter, which is really challenging and constantly throws up paradoxes. So back to the notion of truth. Truth and knowing yourself is really, really hard. And traditionally, the fool or the bard or the storyteller is the person that handed down the stories, the histories, but also the tradition of the fool. The fool is the wise man and the wise man is the fool. So again, we're presented with paradox all the time. And in times of peace, art flourishes and language flourishes, and we're encouraged to be sort of open and honest and sharing and patriotic. But in times of war, it becomes deceit that is cherished. And we have espionage and code and spying, and we're constantly faced with paradox. On beauty, I'd thought about beauty a lot when coming to this piece. So the opening consideration about beauty is in starting to find ways through the world and ways through science and religious narratives, numbers are a key part of that. So the critical numbers in humanity, such as the apostles, prime numbers, feature again and again across all perennial systems of learning. And I thought I'd look at the seven heavens for today, but only up to Tiferet, the point of the heart, which is beauty. It's the place of beauty traditionally. And I belong to a Kabbalistic tradition that is too Jewish to be Christian and not Jewish enough, too Christian to be Jewish. I'll get my words tangled up. And my family crosses racial, gender, and social boundaries. So I live those liminal spaces. I don't just make, I'm not a voyeur, I'm not a flaneur, I'm inhabiting those spaces. And the seven heavens start with devotion and are followed by purity and then sincerity and then awakening. And at that point you reach the heart, which is Tiferet, where all the world's body, psyche, spirit and divine meet. And it's the place of hope, charity and faith. And the phrase is, there's nothing new under the sun, and Tiferet represents the sun. So you have to go above and beyond that. But Tiferet and beauty and knowledge of the self, the place of the watcher, also has its shadow side. So along with beauty, you have pride and despair. And it's the place that we fall back from into the animal and vegetable worlds. It's governed by the default mode network or the ego, and represents the place of testing. And art is able to deal with all of those things in a really transpersonal level. So it has an external transpersonal role in society and creates safe spaces to examine that. But it also creates sacred spaces. And I think the internet and what we're doing here, because Humanity Rising is a wonderful, sacred, growing organism, is to be really careful with how we make our sacred spaces and where we make them. And also be aware that in our kind of scientific, artistic progress, we don't lose the sight that although birth and death are, birth and life are celebrated, death is kind of not addressed in many of our cultures. And it is a part of our life cycle. And immortality and creative acts, so we have Pygmalion and Galathea who are striving to make the perfect woman, and we have this ongoing love-hate relationship with AI and fantasies of Terminator alongside nanotech health, an absolute smorgasbord of possibilities lie in front of us. But the immortality almost forgets death, and death is a process and a vital process in nature, and we can't allow anything new without making space for it. And the notion that we can somehow avoid death is also, or accepting death is also perhaps a revolutionary act. And COVID has allowed us to do that and also connect, because we're not isolated with COVID, we're privileged, we have the internet. Imagine COVID without the internet. It's a very different experience. And so notions of death allow space, and into that space is allowed grace. So our revolutionary acts here for the next year will be looking at the grace that COVID has allowed us, continuing to write positive narratives and looking at ways to connect with our community and with the wider community. And I'm just so delighted to have been a part of this as part of my recovery process. And if you want to look at the works, obviously you can go to the website and look at that. But I really wanted also to speak about abstraction and the human body, because the human body doesn't lie. The human body is in a constant state of change and is constantly trying to communicate to us. So it's possibly enough to say about that for the minute, but lots and lots of things that the human body tells us every day, whether it's hungry, whether it's tired, whether we need to sleep, whether we need to go to the loo, and all of this we take for granted. And our bodies are the vessels of all our other experience. The psyche interfaces, the intellect comes down, and then we, whether we accept it or not, or wish to have it, or wish to name it as that, the divine can then enter into the body. And only in the body are all worlds held and experienced. So yeah, truth is a revolutionary act at the moment.
Ooh, thank you. Thank you. I love your statement that you're too Jewish to be Christian and too Christian to be Jewish. I think that pertains, Sally, to just about all of us as we globalize every part of ourselves. We're no longer in silos. We're an amalgamation of our identities as we've inherited them and our identities as we're becoming more fully human. So I'd love to, the four panelists, to unmute yourselves and come.
Oh, Jim, sorry there. It's been a technical issue. You muted yourself. I don't know how this happened. Just restart from the top of your sentence.
Yeah, if the four panelists could all unmute yourselves, and Georg, if you could put us on group mode. I'd like to start with Sally's notion that under current circumstances, honesty is a revolutionary act. In a world of fake news, what is true becomes revolutionary. And I just love David and Asperide, you to comment on that, and maybe with a view of under the current circumstances of what does art and the revolution mean to you in a time of COVID, when scientists are telling us we're running out of time to solve the problems? What would you say about that as both artists and revolutionaries? Honesty as a revolutionary act in a time of COVID. What's the most revolutionary act we can engage in right now?
Well, Jim, I'd like to say that we were often asked, what does it take to be a peace child? And we thought about this a great deal. And it came down to two qualities, the quality of selflessness, being of service to others, and integrity, telling the truth. And in many of the leaders, including, I'm afraid, your own, we see a total absence of those qualities. And it's very worrying. So I was inspired by Sally's thought. I don't think it's necessarily revolutionary, but it's absolutely essential to be able to live your life as a community. Without honesty, everything else dies. Without a sense of caring and without a sense of selflessness, everything else becomes impossible. And so I think, you know, in the face of some of the most appalling leadership I've ever encountered in my lifetime in government, yes, perhaps it is revolutionary, but boy, do we need that revolution.
Thank you. That's a beautiful notion, that without honesty, everything else dies. That is so profoundly true. And it's the truth that sets us free. Well put. Well, Sparaday, what would you say?
I would like to offer a light comment and then another one, maybe a little deeper. But the light comment is thinking of COVID and art. It's been interesting to see how the shape of the virus has been immediately turned into art everywhere. Mm-hmm. From the emoticons that we were sharing to everywhere, which I think is somehow is a way to for people to, you know, feel that they have some kind of power on this virus by representing it. And also we put in smiley faces. It was a way, okay, let's make it a little less aggressive because we can manage this. But I also think it's interesting because it's a testimony to the deep desire of humans to always create representation and to create representation that elicit emotion, whether they're beautiful or not, in this case, maybe not, but they do elicit an emotion because when we see, you know, the different expressions of the virus, immediately it's our different expressions. So I found that interesting as we're speaking of art. And then I think, well, maybe it's my personal deformation, but I would say the most revolutionary act now is really to use all those qualities that Sally was talking about, put them together and create community, but really create community. You know, going back to the land, going back to community with the earth and say, okay, what is really important? You know, I think that as part of authenticity, honesty comes with authenticity, is also what do we really need? You know, and one of the positive things is maybe by being locked down, we've seen that there are so many things that we don't need and there are others that we so much need that we don't have. So the whole idea of really saying, what are the values? What is important now? And everything is being shifted. And maybe we realize, and again, maybe it's a silly example, but if I'm in California, I'm not going to drink San Pellegrino water because somebody told me that is the best water. What water do I have here? How do I take care of the water here, wherever I am? And where is here now? You know, I think one of the most important questions for each one of us now is to ask ourselves, where is the here where I want to be now? Because this is going to be very relevant for the next years, to be in the right place with the right people that we can create community with.
Well, thank you. That's a profound notion. Sally was talking about the transpersonal dimension of art, and you're talking about the community as a revolutionary act. And, you know, if you think about it, everyone, that's really true. We're under lockdown. We got to wear masks. We're told not to touch and engage in social distancing. So really, forming community is a revolutionary act. And how do you do that within the constraints of the particular circumstance within which you find yourself? So that's very good, Desperate. Thank you. And your notion that the coronavirus became an art form almost immediately. And there was discussions. Charles Eisenstein did this big blog post that went viral all over the world about the coronation. The COVID crisis was the coronation of humanity, the crown. And immediately there was all kinds of artistic images, which shows how instinctive artistic creativity really is. No matter how bad or how good or how anything is, people immediately do a YouTube or do a satire or somehow make it into humor, creativity, and beauty. It's a very, very, very good point. Thank you. David Pearl. Well, did you want to add something, David? Welcome.
Yeah, Jim, I just feel very, very concerned that nobody's mentioned my friends in Minsk and Belarus at this moment, because they're actually doing a revolution at this moment as we speak. Mm. And they're suffering badly. And boy, do they need songs. And my friend Stas Namin, with whom we did Peace Child in Moscow, he's just set to music a wonderful poem by Yevtushenko called Revolt. And it's very complex in Russian, but basically what Yevtushenko is saying that as he became more famous, his colors ran dry because he stopped protesting, he stopped revolt, you know, he stopped rebelling. And that's what happens to us when we get too comfortable. We have to keep rebelling or we're dead. And that's the song that forms the heart of the new Peace Child show in Moscow, which is called Strike. And that's what we need to inform our friends, and everything we can do, our prayers, our good wishes, our money, everything that we can send to our friends in Belarus is what we're doing at the moment. Because it looks like they may not succeed, you know, and that's the tragedy. We've got to be able to push out autocrats and dictators who ruin people's lives and take over whole countries. So I really wanted to bring them to the conversation. Mm,
thank you. Thank you. I know the opposition leader has called for a nationwide strike, but Lukashenko seems pretty well ensconced at the moment anyway. But as they say, a week is a long time in politics, and it worked in the Ukraine, at least temporarily. And let's hope the Belarusia follows suit. But thank you. Thank you. Thank you for that, David. David Pearl, what do you say about these matters? Oof. What's the revolutionary act? What's the revolutionary act of our time?
Well, I think two things. I think one is salons, which are very, I see them everywhere springing up, these communities that you talk about, SB, mm-hmm. and this kind of, people are getting pretty ingenious about reaching out in a way that they weren't a year ago, because they were busy and atomized and on planes. So I think there's that. I think in a funny way, as Sally was saying, this technology, you know, can be purposed in different ways, but there is something about the way that it enables us to cluster. It's a little bit like the printing press, the leaflet, the pamphlet. So I think I'm optimistic about the ability of people to find each other and sort of like the grass to grow through the pavement. I hear what David says, and I think that we have not felt the urgency and the discomfort of many of our fellow citizens around the world, but there's something again about art that it's kind of, frustration is fuel for art. There's a kind of, it doesn't come out of a place of satisfaction. There's an element of dissonance. As you know, John le Carré says, the cat sat on the mat is not a story. The cat sat on the dog's mat is a story. And I think that, you know, from a fairly well-heeled and rather complacent society like my own, I'm in London, hitherto I would say that politics was regarded as a kind of marginal exercise, whereas now I think people are realizing that everything you care about is attached to politics. And I think it's going to be stormy, but I think there's a way in which this Mother Nature is activating us in ways that are going to get, you know, art has got a lot of, it's got a lot of Sturm und Drang in it. It's not pretty. Huh? So I feel like you were saying this at the school in Chartres 2 years ago, Jim. It was a bit like Uranus and Pluto are here to jazz things up a bit, hold the hell on. But on the other hand, it had to change. So, I'm sorry, I'm rambling. But the other thing I thought about art is it's us talking back to us. The thing that I find consoling about art, I did an exercise of conducting Beethoven earlier in the year, which I'd never done before. And it's a bit like it's like the Lascaux cave paintings. There's something ineffably human in it. And art is there telling us about what we need to learn so we don't have to learn the painful lesson. One or the other, the lesson needs to be learned.
Yes. Yes. One way or another, the lesson must be learned.
Sturm und Drang, someone said they don't know what that means. It means it's almost, I come from a Jewish background and they use it in kind of Yiddish way, but it literally means storm and chaos. And it's that kind of, it's the kind of ferment, the crucible of chaos out of which art comes.
Yeah. And I think that the point, David, you were making from Yevtushenko, that is art dried up as he ceased protesting, as he became more famous. And I remember in that Soviet period how hard the authorities worked to get Yevtushenko to be tame, to be the great Soviet hero artist, but to be tame, to support the regime. And you could feel him wrestling with his own soul all the seductions of spirit and flesh were made available to him, if only he would tame his art. And there's many, many examples of the seduction of the spirit in the art and revolutionary arena. So thank you for bringing in that point. So we're coming close to our time. So let's start with you, Sally, and then David Pearl, and then Asperide, and then David Wolcom. Give us a minute on art and the revolution and what you would invite all of us to contemplate more deeply about this matter of culture and history. Sally?
Okay, for me, it is that even if we're following truth, it's paradox. Our world is full of paradoxes. So our truth is our personal truth, our societal truth, our collective truth, our archetypal truth. And what happens if my truth is something different from somebody else's? There has to be a communication. Also an understanding that we are very sophisticated with symbol, sign, and language, and that our consciousness constantly filters and abstracts. And I think it's about knowing yourself, understanding that change is constant, and yes, know thyself, be compassionate, have discrimination, and look for beauty, but positive narratives.
Yeah, positive narratives within the paradox of truth. I love that. Good one. David Pearl.
Listen, I was going to say something quite pragmatic, which is, in its broadest sense, is support the arts. You know, in a simple sense, there's 250,000 people in the UK work in theatre, haven't had a penny since February. And so, you know, what I'm doing is projects that work with those people and so on. But actually, in a broader way, support the arts by becoming an artist. So I think going back to what Asperide was saying also, and again, what George was saying, and what Sally was saying, and what we're all saying is, you know, when you exercise the artist in you, you give agency. It's not just through protest and Twitter and being right and argumentation. There's something quiet and brooding and incredibly powerful about tapping into your own access to the arts at whatever level and in whatever way. And I think that in that way we become symphonic. I think often arts is thought of as a kind of solitary exercise in an attic. But I think when you see the synchrony with people marching as we did in Les Mis, you see people doing stuff in the same time, synchronically, I think that is an unstoppable wave. And we can't just leave that to the artist, we need to all be artists.
Mm. Art is agency. That's profound, David. Thank you so much. It's art is an act of will. It's a conscious choice to enter into the Sturm und Drang of the paradoxes that grip our individual, communal, national, and global world. Well said. Asperide.
Yeah, I was going to say something similar to David. I would say try the arts, to really trust that there is that divine spark of creativity in all of us, to really not be shy, to just play as if we were 5 years old, to find it again. And I read in the comments, someone wrote, we are being evolved. So if we are being evolved, if that's the narrative we choose, then let's try art to create the new story that Sally was talking about, the new narrative, because only art and having the courage to try really in every form, even if it's all collage, we can all do it. And then that allows us to break out the way, not only of thinking, also feeling about reality and life. So that I think is revolutionary. All of us, each one of us.
Yep. Art and the creative process of humanity becoming more whole.
Yes.
You know, it's, and I think that's what links all of us to beauty, you know, is we're all trying to, in some way, distorted in many cases and wrongheaded in many cases, all of us are in the process of evolutionary change toward beauty. And so that's the divine spark. I mean, that's a very important other dimension to this whole conversation. So thank you, Asperity. Good one. And Domenher, my God. And I have to just say, everyone, if you have not been to Domenher and you want an artistic expression experience that will blow your mind.
I think I'm coming as soon as lockdown's over, please.
Temples of Humankind will blow your mind as a creative expression of the intensity of spirituality in our time that makes the evolution of the divine spark more possible. So Sperde's striking a very profound note here. Thank you, Sperde. Good one. David, welcome.
I am back with you, but can you hear me?
Yes.
Listen, just so beautiful to be in the presence of people like this very, and I never heard of the...
Oops.
David, it seems as if you're breaking up.
Can you not hear me?
Yeah, make sure your video's turned off, David. Turn off your video.
Yeah. There Can you go. Hear now, me now?
Yeah, now, there you go. There you go.
Okay, I was just going to say that David Pearl's question, artists ask the unanswerable questions. That's reminded me of the Ezra Pound statement, artists tell the news that stays news. And that's why artists are so important. We have a job to do. It reminds me also of Bobby Kennedy's statement, some people see the world as it is and ask why. I look at the world as it might be and say, why not? And that's the words of an artist, frankly, because that's what we are looking at. We need to dream. We need to encourage young people to dream. We need them to think beyond, out of the box, to think beyond the world as it is right now, and to say why not, and to imagine it. But in Peace Child, we go a step further. We demand that their dreams be plausible, be viable, be actually doable, because unrealistic dreams that can never be done are actually toxic to the revolution. The revolution has to have a plausible, viable way of being implemented. And that's why I think the United Nations needs to be at our side, and all the research and thought leadership that's happened in that wonderful organization over the last 75 years should inform what we're doing, because ill-informed artists bullshitting at the side of the crowd actually aren't very much help. Yes, we can create beauty. Yes, that's important. Yes, we can inspire through our music. And a lot of what we're doing is surreal, and that's wonderful too. So there's room in the artistic world for everyone. But where my little niche in it is, and I hope there'll be others who'll join me on this little cave of artists, is that we actually look at the future and dream of a revolution that is plausible, that's viable. And I encourage people to think about that question, because I think it is, it's an important one as we look down the tunnel of the next 75 years at huge challenges without the leaders, with dysfunctional governments and institutions that are actually often leading us in entirely the wrong directions, unviable, unplausible directions. We need to think creatively, to ask the unanswerable questions, but also look to the plausible outcomes. And that's my word, my thought.
Oh, thank you. Thank you all. You know, art is the revolutionary act of art is honesty, is nurturing the divine spark, is agency, and keeping it real. You know, dream big, start small, scale organically. That's what we all have to do at every level of our existence right now. There's no doubt about it. So I want to thank all of you for a very rich and layered conversation. I know there's an after session starting now. Stan, you or one of your people can put the link in, and all of you presenters are invited to join an after session, which is more informal. You can stay 5-10 minutes, however long or short that you need. There, the link just went in the chat. It's a wonderful time to just debrief a little bit in a more informal atmosphere where everyone can talk to one another who's on the call. Tomorrow, we will turn to our youth. We heard from them on Saturday and from last week, and our youth carry the revolutionary fervor. Revolution is the purview of young people, and at least those that are young at heart. So we want to make sure as humanity rising unfolds that we're listening to the youth in an ongoing way, even during the week that follows. On the U.S. election, there will be millennials speaking about what they're doing and how they're impacted by whatever the outcome is. And I just want to note, due to a totally unsolicited synchronicity, on Wednesday, we're going to be hearing from Chile. They just had their plebiscite where they overturned the Pinochet constitution and are re-democratizing the country. So Carlos Presser and some Chilean colleagues who are establishing Humanity Rising Chile, Chile Rising, will be with us on Wednesday to talk about, they'll give us a report on the election and what they're doing in Chile to bring Humanity Rising to that very, very noble land. So thank you, everyone. Sally, David, Desperide, David, you've been wonderful. You've exceeded all my expectations. You've brought the art to revolution and the revolution to art in a radically contemporary way that's inspired us all. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. We'll see you all tomorrow. Same time, 5 o'clock Central European time. Make sure you account for daylight savings time, which is starting in various parts of the world. Bye.